questo è un seminario del ciclo Decifri Satesis, ciclo che teniamo qui a Trento in collaborazione tra l'Università di Trento e la Fondazione Bruno Kessler. L'ospite di oggi è Daniele Venturi, che tra l'altro è stato per un breve periodo anche nostro collega qui a Trento, un brevissimo periodo comunque è stato. Lo ringraziamo molto per essere qui, adesso lui è a Roma, a Sapienza, e si occupa molto di temi legati ai protocolli crittografici. Ma in realtà la sua ricerca spazia su moltissimi temi, con una certa enfasi sulla parte di dimostrabilità dei claim che vengono fatti sulla sicurezza. Oggi ci parlerà di questo tema un po' di nicchia, ma che sta prendendo, secondo me, sempre più importanza. Prego, Daniele.
Okay, good. So welcome everybody. Thanks for the nice introduction. I will talk today about this the renewed interest in cryptography, which is about immunizing cryptographic primitives against subversion. So let me try to give you like a little bit of context first on a very high level, and let me do that using a running example, which will also be what I will be focusing on for the rest of the talk. And this is about provable security. Right? So like provable security is a very successful methodology in order to make mathematical statements about the security of cryptographic primitives. And so let's see how it looks in a concrete example. For instance, for the case of digital signatures that I assume everybody knows what they are. Okay? So we have a digital signature. How do we model security of such a beast? We think of a game between an adversary on the right and a challenger on the left. And so this game tries to capture what are the abilities of the attacker in the real world. Okay, so in particular, in the real world, there will be a pair of keys, a public key, which is the green key, and a secret key, which is the red key, okay, for the digital signature. And the adversary, of course, knows the public key, right? So then, I mean, in real life, the adversary is most likely will be able to observe signatures generated under the secret key of Alice. Okay? So this is captured in this game in a very worst case sense. In fact, the attacker can even choose which messages Alice is going to sign. Okay? So like a very worst case assumption, the adversary can choose the messages that Alice is going to sign. Okay? For every such request, chosen by the attacker, the challenger signs the message and let the adversary learn the outcome of the signature process. And this can be repeated many times, okay? Okay, like a number of times. Okay, and now, when do we say that the attacker successfully breaks our signature scheme? If it is able to forge a signature which is valid, okay, so everybody will accept it, everybody knowing the public key of Alice in particular. On a message which is denoted in red in the picture, which, however, must be fresh. Okay, so like the message needs to be different from messages that were already on which already the attacker observed the signatures. Okay, so this property is called unforgeability, and it kind of models security of signatures, right? By saying if you don't know the secret key, you cannot produce a signature. Okay, and this is true even if you have seen other signatures. And in fact, even in the worst case scenario where you can choose the messages that Alice can sign. Okay, this is very standard. And in particular, we know how to construct digital signatures that satisfy this property under standard and fairly standard assumptions. Okay. But I mean, one important assumption underneath this entire methodology is the fact that we need to trust the implementation. Okay. So in particular, we are not stating this assumption explicitly, but when we say a signature scheme is secure under this definition, we do assume that the algorithm gen and the algorithm sign, okay, and the verification algorithm as well of the signature scheme, they faithfully follow what is the specification of the digital signature, okay, that somebody designed. So, however, in practice, this assumption might simply turn out to be false. And actually, history taught us that this assumption is too good to be true. And I mean, so why history taught us through Edward Snowden, right? So, like, you probably know about the NSA efforts and the Snowden revelations. I mean, like very briefly, what Snowden revealed is that, so there was a cryptographic standard that was not a digital signature, it was a PRG, okay? So like a deterministic algorithm that is able to generate a pseudorandom sequence. And so the deal with this is that this was using cryptographic standards, ANSI and ISO standards in particular, for many years. For instance, it was used inside Juniper routers, okay? Because it's like a standard which was very widespread. Yet it became evident that who designed the standard did it in a sneaky way. So in particular, this algorithm is based on elliptic curves. And so if you know what they are, so there are two points which are kind of public parameters for computing this algorithm. And then there are two points in particular that are linked through some secret trapdoor, which supposedly is used in order to generate the parameters and then thrown away. So however, Snowden provided evidence that the NSA was actually keeping this parameter. And actually, well, this was already known that if you know this parameter, you can completely bypass the security of this thing. And in particular, you can predict future outputs of the PRG. And then since the PRG is used to encrypt stuff, you can also decrypt whatever is encrypted under this key. Which means that you can do mass surveillance, okay? This was the evidence that Snowden was giving, okay? So what I will try to do today, I kind of try to give the take of a provable security on this kind of attacks. And I will do this, although this is like a very general and broad question, I will try to do it just focusing on signatures for simplicity, such that we have like a very concrete thing to look at, okay? So let's do it for signatures, okay? So what does it mean to subvert the signatures? Well, the most natural thing that you could do is like you subvert the signature algorithm, okay? So this signature algorithm is supposed to like take as input the message and the secret key, and it outputs a signature. Now there is a subverted signature algorithm that can be specified by an adversary, and this subversion will be denoted with this exclamation mark, okay, in the slides. Okay, so now this algorithm is not the original algorithm anymore. And now one can say, okay, well, this is maybe too hard, right? I mean, like if I can subvert arbitrarily the signature algorithm, then I can do whatever I like. Let's just pretend that the signature algorithm outputs the secret key, okay? And then everything is broken, right? However, we can observe, look, this attack, true, it breaks the signature, but it is very easy to detect, right? Because if we look at this implementation of the algorithm, if we test it, right, and we try to run it, we are going to see that instead of producing a valid signature, it produces the secret key, right? It outputs the secret key. Okay, very suspicious, right? So this is detectable. So maybe there is a more sneaky way to do subversion. So like, what about this, for instance? Like, so the signature algorithm produces a sequence of signatures, okay? Which this time look like genuine signatures. Okay? In particular, if you verify these signatures with the green key, which corresponds to the red key, the verification will be successful, for instance, okay? So everything looks fine, yet collecting enough of these signatures, the attacker is able to extract the secret key, okay? So, and now the goal of the attacker is to design a strategy that is successful at extracting the secret key while at the same time being undetectable, in a sense, okay? Which is kind of what happened with this dual EC PRG, because it was like a perfectly fine PRG, except that the NSA retained this secret trapdoor. Okay, so that's kind of the high level idea. And actually it's very curious. It turns out that this question is very old. Okay, like, I mean, if you look at the cryptographic literature in 1996, it was already posted by Young and Jung with this paper, which is called The Dark Side of Black Soil Cryptography, or Should We Trust Capstone? So in particular, they uncovered the possibility of this kind of subversion attacks, which was like completely theoretical, okay? Like completely of theoretical interest. And they showed indeed that some RSA-based implementations can be subverted in this way, like in the way of this slide. Okay, in the sense that you can tweak the generation of the keys, you can tweak the signature algorithm in such a way that that such attacks are possible. Okay? So, and then this kind of was forgotten for some years. I mean, it was kind of hot for like a few years, but then it got forgotten. And now it got renewed attention because of these revelations by the NSA actually doing this in real life. Although for different algorithms, but okay, so that's what I will try to do for the rest of the talk. Okay, I will have two main technical parts, which are based partially on my contributions to the field. Okay, the first part is uncovering the power of subversion attacks. Okay, so I will show you, in fact, that subversion attacks can be sneaky and also very powerful, though. Okay, completely breaking security. And I will do this for the case of signatures, okay? Again, just to be focused on a concrete application. So in particular, this is based on my work, which appeared at CCS 2015 and also now at the TCS journal last year, which is about subversion of signature schemes. Okay, and then in the second part instead, I will move to countermeasures, okay? I will try to talk about countermeasures, and I will do this again, looking at the case of signatures, and then pointing out at generalizations for other cryptographic primitives. So let's try to formalize by means of provable security. First of all, what do we mean that a subversion attack is undetectable? So we could try to think of this like as a security game, okay? Where now, right, the goal of the attacker now is to subvert the signature algorithm in such a way that the user, which is going to be the challenger in this case, right, cannot detect it. Okay, so like the goal of the attacker is not being detected. So what does it mean that the subversion is not detected? We can think of it as follows: like the attacker chooses an algorithm, which is the subversion of the signature algorithm. Okay, so for simplicity, now when we talk about attacks, I will only focus on the case where the attacker can only subvert the signature algorithm, okay? Which is, of course, like better because, I mean, it's worse from the point of view of the adversary, okay? So the attacker can only subvert that algorithm, right? So it's gonna be harder for the attacker to break security by only subverting the signature algorithm without subverting the other algorithms, right? So instead, just as an aside, when I will move to countermeasures, I will be interested in the case where the attacker can subvert everything. So, but now let's focus on the case where the attacker can only subvert the signature algorithm. Okay, so now it produces the subversion, then the challenger generates a pair of keys and gives the public key to the attacker. Okay, and now, so the attacker is gonna be given the ability to sign messages. So it needs to distinguish between two situations. Okay, like situation number one is the challenger is gonna use the subverted implementation, and situation number two is the challenger is gonna use the original signature algorithm. Okay. And now the attacker needs to distinguish between these two situations. Okay. So now the attacker, you should think of the attacker here as the user. Indeed. Okay. So like, so the user is trying to distinguish whether a given subversion is in place or not. Okay, so like the attacker can do this. So the user can kind of like interrogate this possibly subverted algorithm many times, and at the end it needs to decide whether it is talking to the subversion or not. Okay, so which essentially means like you cannot distinguish whether this thing is the real signature algorithm or not. Public undetectability means, right, for all adversaries, you cannot distinguish, okay? So like the probability that you guess the bit B correctly is roughly 1/2. And I mean, so this is like, you know, undetectability if you know only the public key, okay? You can consider like even a stronger form where you actually know the secret key, right? So like, I mean, this is kind of like who is going to detect the subversion, right? I mean, maybe the signer is the one that tries to detect subversion, or maybe an ordinary user that only know the public key is gonna detect subversion. It's like two flavors, okay? So secret undetectability means you can even choose the secret keys. Okay? And even if you can choose the secret keys, you are not able to understand the difference between the subversion and the original algorithm, okay? And now, I mean, of course, there is a subtle point, right? That, I mean, if you look at this definition in isolation, this is trivial to achieve, right? I mean, if I decide that the subversion is the original signature algorithm, this is clearly undetectable subversion because it's identical to the original signature algorithm, right? So to make the question non-trivial, right, the goal of the attacker is to produce a subversion which is at the same time undetectable, okay? So it cannot be distinguished from the original, okay? Either given only the public key or given both the public key and the secret key, but at the same time, it allows to compute the secret key, okay? Okay, so these two properties need to be satisfied at the same time, right? Because one property in isolation is of course trivial. Okay, so the tricky bit is you need to do both, right? Both subvert the signature in such a way that it's not detectable, and to use it in order to get the key. So, and moreover, there is a framework which is called like strong undetectability. This is also like something that an attacker might try to achieve, which is to say the subversion of the signature algorithm is stateless. Okay, so it is not allowed to keep state, which is of course like a weaker kind of subversion, right? Because I mean, if I can subvert an algorithm in such a way that they can, that it can keep state, of course the subversion is more powerful, but maybe there are better ways to detect such kind of subversion, right? Like, I mean, in particular, if you reset the state, right, you can see how it behaves, how the algorithm behaves, right? So, of course, it will be more desirable for the adversary to produce a subversion strategy which is stateless. It does not need to use any state, okay? Because this will be better deployable for the purpose of breaking security. So we will seek for subversion that at the same time they are stateless, undetectable, and on the other end, they allow to extract the secret key efficiently. Okay? So this is kind of the goal, okay? And I mean, the previous definition is only for one user. There is only one pair of keys, at least in the public key setting, right? In the secret key setting, it's not like this because the attacker can even choose the secret keys. But I mean, you can even consider like extension to multiple users, although I will not do it for the purpose of simplicity in this talk. Okay, so now let me give you an attack, okay, which is able to do essentially this thing, okay? This is what I was drawing here, okay? Like how can you can do this, okay? You want to subvert the signature algorithm in such a way that by looking at a bunch of signatures, you can extract the key efficiently. Okay, on the one end. On the other end, the subversion is undetectable in the sense of this definition. Okay, so nobody can distinguish between the real signature algorithm and the subverted one. Okay, so and the idea will be to attack signature schemes that are sufficiently randomized. Okay, so in particular, this attack will try to do the following on a very intuitive level. Before going to the technical details, this algorithm will do this. It will pick the randomness of the signature algorithm in a biased manner, such that by observing enough signatures, you can indeed compute the secret key. Okay? So let's see how this can be done. Okay, so the subversion is going to use a couple of hardwired constants. Okay, the first is just a constant, like a number, tau. And the second one is the key for a PRF. If you know what a PRF is, good. If you do not know, you can think of it as AES. This could be AES. Okay. But I mean, the property that we need from this PRF is that essentially its output is indistinguishable from random for a fixed choice of the key. Okay, so we have this key. Okay, and now we do the following. Okay, so the idea is this. We keep signing the message multiple times. Okay, we pick the random coins R for producing the signatures many times. Okay. When do we stop? Well, we stop when the following condition happens. We take the signature that is produced, we evaluate the PRF on this signature, okay, and now we interpret the output of the PRF as a pair. Okay. The first value is, or like maybe let's look at the second value. So the second value is an index I, okay? And this corresponds to the position of one of the bits of the secret key, okay? Position I. And the first value is a bit, the value V is a bit, which is either 0 or 1. Okay. So when are we happy? We are happy if by computing the PRF on the signature, we get the ith bit of the secret key. Okay, so we keep doing this. We keep signing the message until for some I, the PRF outputs the ith bit of the secret key. Okay, so that's what we do. We keep doing this. And I mean, maybe we are unlucky and we don't want to run forever. So when do we stop? Well, in the worst case, we stop after tau repetitions. Okay. And then at the end, we output the signature. So one observation might be that in the end, this process is going to take longer than just assigning once. Which is probably a good point. Although, I mean, we will not look at this kind of timing based detection for the purpose of this talk. Now we have this thing, right? Okay, and now we kind of try to prove the following theorem that, this attack is strongly secretly undetectable, which means it is stateless, okay? The fact that it's stateless is clear because there is no state. And moreover, I claim it is secretly undetectable, which means even if you know the secret key, even if you can choose the secret key, you cannot distinguish the output of this algorithm from the output of the original algorithm, okay? So as you see, this definition of undetectability doesn't take into account the timing. It's just kind of a black box indistinguishability thing, right? Okay, so that's the first thing. And the second thing is that it efficiently allows to recover the secret key, okay, with very large probability. Okay, so and the attacker is very simple. Okay, so what does the attacker do? The attacker produces this subversion and then it proceeds as follows, that is gonna fix this, starts with the key being all 0, and then obtain Q signatures on messages M1 to MQ, okay? And then for each signature, compute the PRF on that signature, get a pair of values, and set the ith bit of the secret key to the output of the PRF, okay? And then output the key. Okay, that's what our attacker does, okay? So now when does the attacker fail? Well, it fails if for at least one signature, we are unlucky, okay? And unfortunately, in the tau repetitions, we cannot achieve this invariant that the value v is equal to the ith bit of the secret key. That's the first bad event, right? And the second bad event is, okay, we are unlucky and we didn't actually recover the entire secret key, okay? So the index I corresponding to each signature does not cover all the positions. So we do not know the entire key, okay? So if these two events do not happen, we are done. We extract the secret key, right? So what we need to prove is that these two events do not happen too often. Session, okay, so let me try to give a sketch of this proof. I mean, it's like actually very simple. It's all mostly like accounting based proof. So what you do is this, right? We do the following game, right? I mean, we generate a pair of keys, and then for two times we try to do this process, right? We sign the message and then we PRF the output, and we hope that the ith bit is equal to V, right? And we keep doing this for every message at most tau times. Okay, this is kind of the pseudocode implementation of what I described in words in the previous slide. Okay, so what is the first natural step that we do in the proof? The first natural step that we do in the proof is that instead of computing this pair vi using f, since f is a PRF, we can compute it using we can just sample it at random. Okay. The only catch is that, the PRF is deterministic, right? So in particular, if the same signature happens twice, we do not pick a new pair, right? So rather what we do is that we store, the pair VI corresponding to each signature in an array. And then if the same signature shows up, we use the previous one, right? Okay, so this perfectly matches the previous game with the only difference that instead of using F, we pick the values at random, with repetition, right? And then, I mean, it's very fairly easy to show that if the PRF is secure, you cannot distinguish the red experiment from the yellow experiment. These two things are the same. Otherwise, you would break the PRF. Okay. So now we are in this yellow world, okay? And then what we do, we want to move to this nice green world, which is much simpler. And what is the difference between the green world and the yellow world is that, you know what, forget about these collisions, okay? So do not keep signatures in the array and then just sample at random the signature, the pair VI all the time for every signature. Just pick a new pair for every time pick a new pair. So of course now, and this is also where, so now in order to do this step, which allows to conclude the proof, we cannot do it for arbitrary signatures, okay? Because if the signature is deterministic, or if it uses like very little randomness, it will be very likely actually that signature collides, right? But so in order to avoid this, we just require that the signature algorithm will have a non-trivial amount of mean entropy. Okay, what does it mean, mean entropy? It means essentially this, like what is the maximum probability that over the choice of the randomness for the signature that a given signature shows up, okay? So this maximum probability is kind of over a worst case choice of the secret key, of the message, and of the signature, okay? So like fix a worst case choice of secret key. So fix the secret key, fix the message, fix the sigma. And now what is the worst probability, what is the max probability, right, that over the choice of the randomness that this signature shows up, okay? So we will say that signature scheme has mean entropy eta if this max is 2 to the minus eta, okay? So which intuitively means if eta is very small, little mean entropy, so little randomness, and if eta is large enough, you know, then, you know, kind of the signature is kind of random. So that's the idea, okay? And then, I mean, I will try to give you like an idea about concrete numbers at the end of the proof, okay? So for now, let's just keep this as a parameter. And now the idea is this, right? I mean, look, so now we are in the green. We want to switch from this yellow to green, right? So, and what is the only difference between yellow and green is collisions. Okay, so if collisions do not happen, then green and yellow are the same, okay? So then, I mean, the note by W, the event that there is a collision, this is gonna happen with like kind of probability, like, so like the probability that a given signature shows up is at most 2 to the minus eta by definition of mean entropy, right? And now how many signatures do we make, right? We make at most, right? For each message, we do tau repetitions and there are Q messages. So there are tau Q signatures. And now, we want to look at any collision, which is like this binomial factor, tau q choose two. So then by union bound, the probability of this event is like what is written in the slide, okay? Like essentially like proportional to polynomial of q times two to the minus eta. Okay, so with this probability, except with this probability, we are good, okay? And now if we condition on this event not happening, so assume that this event doesn't happen, then we are in the green world. And now everything becomes like counting, okay? Because in this green world, there are no repetitions. Every time we pick a new pair, right? So for the event E1, for instance, right? What is the probability that we do not manage to finish the loop before tau repetitions? Well, you know, in each repetition, the value V is gonna hit the ith bit with probability 1/2 because it's random, right? And then, which means that, right, we need to be unlucky all the times, right? Probability 2 to the minus tau, right? And then by union bound, we get Q times 2 to the minus tau, right? That's the first thing. And then the second thing, what is the probability that we do not hit the position I? Well, you know, like the position I is gonna be hit with probability 1 by L, right? So we are unlucky, the event that we are unlucky is like 1 minus 1 over L to the Q. And by union bound, we need to multiply also by L. So these two probabilities can be bounded by these values. And then, you know, like, so now it's all like a kind of a choice of parameters, okay? So like, I mean, so let's first look at the parameters, I mean, or like rather, okay? So I mean, yeah, so then, I mean, the proof works like in general with these parameters. So let me comment on the parameters in a second. I mean, on the other hand, let me move for a second to undetectability, right? I mean, once we are in the green world, right, look at the green world, well, this signature algorithm is completely identically distributed to the original signature algorithm. And why is that? Well, because, you know, the choice of VI is completely independent of everything, right? It's just a pick VI at random, independently of sigma, independently of M, independently of SK, which means that the distribution produced by this signature is just exactly the same as the original signature algorithm, okay? which makes the attack secretly undetectable. Okay. This is true even if you know the secret key. Okay. So what about parameters? Well, just like for fun, I mean, just put some numbers. Like for instance, if you want to look, if you want to recover the secret key of this RSA PSS, then you can compute that the probability of success is gonna be like 0.7 by setting Q to roughly to 15,000 and tau 18. Okay, like you need to do 18 repetitions, which is not too large, although you need to collect a fairly large amount of signatures, okay, 15,000 signatures. And this works as long as the mean entropy is kind of at least 38 bits, okay, which is not not very large. Okay, and then for ECDSA, where the key is even shorter, right, this elliptic curve basting, so then you get probability of success, which is 0.85, so long as you collect like fairly smaller amount of signatures, like roughly 2,000, and then again, tau repetitions for 15 repetitions, and mean entropy roughly 40. Okay. Okay, so this shows that at least on paper, right, if you can subvert signatures, in particular, you can bias the randomness, you can completely break security. So in the paper, we show like a few extensions to this. I mean, in particular, what about signatures that instead have a small mean entropy, right? This attack will not work in that case. So we show that there exists an attack also for those, although this attack needs to be stateful. Okay? So it's not stateless anymore. And yeah, so, and this attack is also based on some special property that I don't want to talk about here, it's not so important. So it doesn't apply to all signatures, but only to those that have a special property. But I mean, many of these, many existing signatures do have this property. Okay? So this is actually affects real world signatures. Okay, and then for more information, I just leave you to the full version of the paper. So now let me move to part two, okay? So after I kind of convince you that subversion attacks are nasty, okay, which could have been like, you know, like maybe not too much surprising, right? Although it is like a little bit subtle, right, to do this thing in an undetectable way. So let me do maybe like move to the more kind of cryptographic and not cryptanalytic perspective, which is, okay, what to do now? I mean, how do we defend against these attacks, okay? So the part two is about clipping the power of subversion attacks. So mainly based on two papers. So the first is the one that introduced this formal modeling, which is called cryptography. And the second one is a work of mine, which is a follow-up on this subject, which appeared at ACNS in 2019, and then recently to the TCS journal in next year. Right, so I mean intuitively, okay, what we want to do is we want to kind of model security of a signature scheme in the presence of subversion. Okay, so think of a very powerful attacker which now can subvert all the algorithms. Okay? This is called complete subversion. Okay, so when we want to make defenses, we make a worst case assumption the attacker can subvert everything, even the generation, even the verification. Okay, okay. So, and I mean, and then what we want is that even if the attacker can do this, still it cannot win, okay? And again, of course, now this is too much to ask, right? Because if the subversion is arbitrary, well, it is simply impossible to do that, right? Like the signature algorithm could output the secret key, or the verification algorithm could always output one, for instance, okay? So, which makes it like impossible to achieve this notion, like too general, okay? So how do they propose, because this is from this paper in 2016 called cryptography. So how do they propose to make this possible? Well, the attack needs to be undetectable again. Okay. So this undetectability is formalized here using an external entity, which is called the watchdog, which is this guy with the lens in the slide. So you should think of this watchdog as you test the algorithm because before using it in the wild, okay? So you want to implement some signature scheme that famous cryptographer invented, and the specification of the scheme, you know it. This is supposed to be like this, okay? So now Although, right, you probably do not implement it yourself, right? So like maybe use some off-the-shelf library or like a bias smart card or whatever. So how can you make sure that what you bought is actually compliant with the specification? Okay? So very reasonable, you test it before using it in the wild. Okay? So that's kind of the undetectability thing. So now this watchdog is essentially running this test. Okay? Like before the scheme is using the wild, try to check whether a given implementation is compliant to the specification. Okay. So then this watchdog runs some test and now either accepts it, like say, okay, it's fine, you can use it. This is not subverted, or it rejects, saying, you know, you better not use it because something is fishy, okay? So that's kind of the idea, okay? So then when do we call a scheme secure in this framework? Well, it's an either or thing, right? I mean, either there is some watchdog that rejects this with large probability. So either the attack is detected with large probability, or if it is not detected, so no watchdog can detect it, then the attacker cannot win the game, where now the game is played with the subverted algorithms, right? So the attacker uses the subverted algorithms, yet he cannot win the game, right? So then when this happens, except with some small probability, okay, this like lambda to the minus omega one just means that this is like small in the security parameter. So we call a scheme secure if either an attack can be detected, or when it is not detected, it's useless. So the attacker cannot break security even using the subverted algorithm. Okay, so that's what, and this clearly rules out all these counter examples, right? Where like the attacker changes the verification algorithm to always output one, you know, changes the signature algorithm to always output the secret key. You simply cannot do this because this is easily detectable. Okay, on the other end, the attack that I showed before, right? It proves that sufficiently randomized signature schemes, they cannot achieve this property, right? Because the strategy that I showed you before is such that it's undetectable, yet it allows to completely to recover the secret key and thus to break security. Okay. So now we want to protect schemes against these kind of attacks. Okay. So let me like point out a few things. I mean, the first thing is about these watchdogs. So the one that I described is called the offline watchdog, which means before using the scheme in the wild, you compare it to the original specification. Okay. So unfortunately, and this is actually the case for signatures, offline watchdogs are not powerful enough. Because, I mean, think of a signature scheme where the message space is large enough. Okay, so there are enough messages. And consider the following attack. I replace the signature algorithm as follows. This algorithm behaves exactly like the original algorithm, except that on a single point, which I choose at random, on a single message, which is like a trigger, it outputs the secret key. Okay. So now, unfortunately, an offline watchdog is not gonna detect this because you know, the message space is so large that the watchdog cannot try them all, okay? So although he can check that the signature scheme is compliant to the specification for some messages, he cannot check them all. And since I picked this message at random, it will not detect my subversion, okay? So this kind of shows that with offline watchdogs, we cannot protect signatures. And since the goal of this talk is kind of to give an overview of signatures, I need to introduce online watchdogs, okay? So online watchdogs, they can look at the transcript, okay? It's not like this, that the watchdog makes the test only when before using the scheme in the wild, but you kind of need to monitor that even while you use it, this is compliant, right? Okay, this is kind of the intuition of this online watchdog, okay? So, I mean, there is even a more powerful watchdog, which is called the omniscient watchdog. This is the watchdog that actually even can look at the internal state, okay? So it knows the secret key, for instance. Okay? We will not need this, but I mean, in principle, one could define it. Okay, So let me try to give some intuition how you can indeed protect the signature schemes against this kind of complete subversion. Okay, so the idea will be to use a methodology which is called the split program and immunization via trusted amalgamation. Okay, so first of all, this split program methodology is gonna say like, look, we already know that if the signature scheme is randomized, we are dead. Okay, so like, let's assume that the signature scheme is deterministic. Okay, and then now the only randomness is used, in fact, to generate the keys. So like, and moreover, let's kind of split this program that generates the key in two parts. Like there is the generation algorithm, and then there is the algorithm that supplies the randomness. Okay, so like, there is a real sort, there is a random source. Okay. And this source is the one that is used to sample the randomness, but otherwise the generation algorithm is completely deterministic. Once you fix the randomness, it's also deterministic, right? So now this, so the idea is now the attacker can subvert everything, okay? So the only thing is that, of course, the randomness is gonna be secret, right? So this is like a secret source of randomness, as it was the case. Now the immunization, we kind of use this, so what is this trusted amalgamation? So the idea will be that, how do we immunize things? Well, we will look at the following strategy. We sample enough randomness, okay? Maybe not just one string, but like K samples. So then we amalgamate them and then hash them using some hash function. Okay, there is a hash function, which is kind of like, trying to destroy subversion, okay? So like the goal of this hash function is to immunize subversion, okay? So then this immunize, and the immunizer itself, it can be subverted, of course, right? So like the immunization is gonna try to protect against the subversion, but the immunizer itself can be subverted, okay? So how do we immunize? We sample enough randomness, amalgamate, hash, okay? And then we get a string, which we use as the randomness to generate the keys. Okay. And then everything else is unchanged. We do not touch the signature algorithm. We do not touch the verification algorithm. Okay. So that will be kind of our strategy for immunization. So, now this immunization, there could be two types, right? I mean, like the first type is the subversion can depend on the hash function, or maybe the subversion depends on the hash function, which is like the second case. This is called public immunization, okay? So this means like, first you pick the hash function, the seed S, then you, first the attacker subverts, then I pick the seed for the hash function, okay? So still the attacker knows the seed, but the subversion cannot depend on it. Okay? I mean, and it's very interesting what we show in the paper that depending on the property that the hash function satisfies, we can get either security in the first model or in the second model. Okay. So, I mean, given the limited time that I have, I will just focus on the first thing, which is simpler, okay? So the first model. So the subversion cannot depend on the seed. Okay, so the question is, which property from H, okay? So what we show is this, that if the hash function is what is called the randomness extractor, okay, like very famous combinatorial object, this essentially means that upon input, a source of randomness, which is not perfect, okay, so it has mean entropies, it has some unpredictability, but it is not uniformly random. This extractor can extract all the possible randomness from it, okay, more or less. So it can produce something which looks like statistically as uniform, okay, given only something that is unpredictable, okay? This is like a very famous object. It can be constructed information theoretically using so-called universal hash functions. Maybe you've heard about the leftover hash lemma. So, I mean, I would just assume that, you are confident with this concept. So I will not explain it further, but I mean, feel free to ask questions later if you have doubts. So we take this object and now we say, if the hash function is an extractor, then with an online watchdog, we can protect signatures in the semi-private model where the subversion cannot depend on the hash function, okay? So that's kind of the idea. So how do you prove such a thing? I mean, let me try to give you like a very brief sketch. It's gonna be very simple. So we have this experiment, right? Where in this experiment, so remember, either we detect subversion, or if we do not detect subversion, then we play the game, okay? So and when we play the game, the adversary is gonna choose the subversion algorithms. Okay, so this is the original game where we play the standard game for signatures. So the adversary needs to forge using the subverted algorithms. Okay. So now in the first kind of game hop to the proof, like we make kind of a mental experiment and we do the following. So instead of using the subverted algorithms that the attacker chooses, we do this. So all the deterministic algorithms, they are replaced with the specific, with the honest algorithms. Okay. Whenever an algorithm is deterministic, we are gonna replace it with the genuine implementation. So gen is gonna be the specification. H is gonna be honest. Sign is honest, verify is honest. So in this game, the only thing that can be subverted is the random source. Okay. So why can we do this? An online watchdog can make sure that these algorithms behave in the right way. So of course the watchdog needs to be online because of this input trigger attack that I showed you. Okay? It's like fairly easy to show. And now once we are in this game, we make another change. And what is the change? Well, the change is that instead of using this thing here, instead of like having a random source which is subverted and sample the source k times and then hash, we just use the original source, okay, without subversion. Okay. So why this is good? Well, it is good because again, a watchdog, so now the source is randomized, okay? So yet, since we know that the original source has a lot of randomness, okay, the subverted source cannot look too much deterministic, right, intuitively. So like, for instance, the watchdog that, you know, samples the source twice and looks for a collision ensures that this random source has enough randomness, okay? How do we measure randomness? By mean entropy, okay? So in particular, it is fairly easy to show that if you sample the source one, it needs to have at least one bit of mean entropy, okay? So now, if you sample k times, you will have k bits of mean entropy, which means now that we are in a position to use the security of the extractor because the input of the extractor has k bits of mean entropy, the seed is uniform, and moreover, and this is the key point, the subversion cannot depend on the seed, right? Otherwise, it would be bad. If the subversion could depend on the seed, then it means that the source can depend on the seed. And now, if the source can depend on the seed, it is probably impossible to construct extractors. Okay, so that's the catch, where we need the assumption that the subversion is independent of the seed. Okay. Okay, so now let me conclude very briefly. I mean, we can actually extend this analysis to the case of public immunizers, although this requires a more complicated object than just an extractor, which is called a seed-dependent randomness condenser. I will not go through this due to the lack of time, but the proof is very similar. Okay, so let me just jump to conclusions. So in the paper, we show also like a few extensions. I mean, whatever I said for signatures, it can actually be extended to many other primitives. And sometimes even to the case where the public source can be subverted, okay? So in particular, we show that it works for these primitives, for instance, okay? Like we have, we have a very nice kind of abstract characterizations such as one-way functions, secret key encryption, this online watchdog, and instead PRFs, one-way permutation and PRPs, they do not, like at least invite you to look at my paper. So let me conclude. So what I wanted to show with this talk is that subversion attacks can be mean, and in particular, they can compromise security of many randomized primitives, as it was proven for by now, already in the 90s, and then it was even more in the recent years shown. On the other hand, we can immunize large class of deterministic primitives against complete subversion. So let me leave you with like a few kind of open questions. There is some work which studies the case of CPA secure encryption, but I mean, apart from that, I would say that this is widely open. And also, can we have alternative models, right, to treat immunization, to treat subversion? Can we construct better immunizers in terms of like security, in terms of efficiency, whatever you like? So if you're interested in these things, like I invite you to join the party and do research on this subject, which is like really fun. And yeah, so with this, I'd like to conclude my talk. Thanks a lot for listening, and I'm open to receive any questions now.